good evening and welcome. My name is Amy Siegel. I'm the Director of Public Programs here at the United States Memorial, Holocaust Memorial Museum. We are so thrilled that you took time out to participate in tonight's program, and we also want to say thank you and welcome to our co-hosts from the 9/11 Memorial and Museum. I'd also like to welcome our digital audience joining from around the globe. We really hope that during tonight's conversation, you'll share your reflections, but also ask questions of our panelists using the hashtag #PowerOfMemory. Tonight's program is part of a series of conversations that we're hosting, examining the power of memory to shape our future. This season, we're taking time out to think about why we remember the events that led to the Holocaust and other global atrocities, and how collective understanding can help us make informed decisions about our future and shape a better world. To learn about this program series and all the conversations and programs that we host, we hope you'll sign up for the museum email and follow us on social media. Some people have questioned, why is there a Holocaust Museum on the National Mall? Or how can we fulfill our mission as a living memorial to the past and the victims while still being relevant enough to engage youth today? I'm sure similar big questions have been asked of the 9/11 Museum about your role and your vision, and tonight's conversation will examine that and more. In that regard, it's important to note that one of our founders, Elie Wiesel, often said this museum is not an answer, but a question. We at the museum say the Holocaust poses many questions, and it's our job to never stop asking why. Tonight, we're joined by Sarah Bloomfield. She's the director of the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, and Alice Greenwald. She's the president and CEO of the 9/11 Memorial and Museum in New York. Sarah and Alice have been good friends and colleagues for more than 30 years, and it's an honor to welcome you back to the museum tonight, Alice. Tonight, they'll give us a behind-the-scenes look into the creation, the design and impact of living memorials, and what they hope the future holds for their institutions and all of us. And now it's my pleasure to introduce tonight's moderator and the esteemed host of NPR's Weekend Edition Saturday and NBC Sunday Morning, Scott Simon.
CBS, actually, but in any event. That's all right, thank you. Oh, my, I wonder how much that little mistake will cost me. Look, it's an honor to be here. My wife and I feel very strongly about any small thing, and there are small things that we're able to do to try and support the work of this institution, and I think yours too, Alice. It strikes me that both of these museums have taken on the task of vivifying memories in a way that make them alive in our lives and makes their importance something that we can touch, that we can hold, that can motivate the rest of us and give our children, for that matter, a sense of direction and purpose and understand that we have sprung out of events that we struggle to understand and yet want to live lives that bring that understanding into the sense of purpose that we can bring them. So thank you. We're here with Sarah and Alice. Let me, couple of housekeeping notes. Each of you received a note card when you may have entered here this evening, sort of the end of the discussion. Ushers will fan out and will collect your cards, so you might have them ready as soon as you can. And for those who are watching from home, you can submit your questions using, I guess that's hashtag power of memory. That's on Twitter. It looks like a Twitter address. And we're in the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, of course, tonight, but our studio and digital audiences may not have been to the 9/11 Memorial Museum in New York. And Alice, I understand you have a tour to give us of that.
Well, we're going to show you a little bit of footage taken by drone in the museum. So you get a sense of what it's like to fly through, which you'll never be able to do. But. We can show that. just want to say what you don't see in this footage are the core exhibitions. The reason being we were not going to put a drone inside small spaces with windy pathways. It would have been much too dangerous for the artifacts. But you'll be seeing some of those images this evening later on.
Alice, you worked here at the Holocaust Memorial Museum for over 20 years, as I understand it. What are some of the lessons that you take from this place that you have brought to New York?
There were several. On the practical side of things, I had the extraordinary privilege of joining this project in the mid-1980s. Sarah and I were both here at that time, and I was part of a design team for what would become the permanent exhibition. But I was able to stay on through the opening of the museum and then to its early years of operation. So I had a kind of a front row seat on how you move from planning and concept to implementation, opening, and having a working museum. And that was extraordinarily valuable when I came to New York because I knew, in effect, the stages we were going to go through. But more importantly, I was exposed to, I consider him a genius, Shaika Weinberg, who was the founding director and the man who really produced the core exhibition, the permanent exhibition here. And I internalized, by watching him and being part of this process, a number of questions. How do you portray explicit content in the public space of a museum? How do you balance commemoration with the documentation of history in a responsible way? What do you do about children, underage visitors? What can you show, what can't you show? All of those questions were ingrained in me, so that when I came to New York, and mind you, it was 5 years after the attacks that we started working on the museum, 2006, the circumstances were different, the history is different, the story we're telling is different, but the questions were the same. And I was able to bring those questions to the process of imagining what this museum could be.
Let me ask about, in instance of each institution, the significance of location. Sarah, the Holocaust Memorial Museum is obviously located thousands of miles from most of the events that are memorialized and portrayed here. What's the significance of having this place on the National Mall?
Location, location, location. Mm-hmm. In the world of Holocaust memory, Alice's museum is Auschwitz for our world. And Auschwitz is about that very place and what happened there. Mm-hmm. Auschwitz, I would say, is the Holocaust, and we are about the significance of the Holocaust, which is a statement because of the piece of real estate that it sits on. It's a very precious piece of real estate. It's not just in Washington, D.C., but it's here on the National Mall. And the architect who designed the museum very much wanted the museum to be in interplay with what is represented on the mall. So here you see in this image the entrance on the 14th Street side, which is meant to speak to that monumental Washington. This is the side that faces most of the Smithsonian. And he wanted people to remember that if you're coming from the Smithsonian, you've seen a lot of wonderful museums speaking to the most creative, remarkable results of human achievement. This museum is also about human achievement, to bad ends, of course. But it is part of that story of human nature. And if you enter the other side of the museum, you come off from the Washington Monument and the Jefferson Memorial, and there you are seeing our monuments to freedom. And the architect designed a lot of windows where you can just barely make out. So you're looking through this kind of lens of the Holocaust, but you see a glimmer of Jefferson and Washington. And then the last thing I would say is we're in the seat of power. And we speak about power, and the power of the individual, and the possibility of the abuse of power. This image is showing what you see when you come in from the entrance on what you might call the freedom side, which is a reminder of American values. So I think we've designed the museum to speak to this piece of real estate.
Is there some statement, too? This is what I must tell you, what I tell our daughters, that this terrible event, it was also part of American history. This is also part of who we are.
Yes, and the permanent exhibition that Alice worked on, and she mentioned our colleague Shaika, who led that effort, that exhibit actually began with the American story, with the American GIs. A little bit of history, since this is meant to be a behind the scenes. We did focus groups before we opened to see, well, what would be the reaction to a Holocaust museum on the Mall, for the very reason you said, Scott, and people said, why Washington? Yeah. So we looked at groups of people who had lived through World War II, hadn't lived through World War II, Jews and non-Jews. And it was very interesting. There was universal agreement that the Holocaust was one of those pivotal events in human history, something everybody should know about. But why would you build it in Washington, people asked? Doesn't it belong in Berlin or Jerusalem? So we designed the architecture and the exhibitions to try to answer that question. So the first part of your museum experience is hearing from that American GI who asked that big question, which is, how is it that human beings can do this to one another? And then throughout the exhibition, we keep bringing back what America knew and when America knew it, and how did America respond or not. And I have to plug, because our 25th anniversary is coming up next year, and we'll be opening an exhibit on America and the Nazi threat that deals specifically with this topic.
Alice, let me get you to talk a bit about the significance of your museum's location. There were a lot of plans in the aftermath when people could dry their eyes and think things through a bit about exactly what should happen to that ground which had been, in a sense, hallowed and consecrated already.
Absolutely. Because we are located at the site of the atrocity, the site, one of the locations of the attacks, it is more like being a museum in a battleground, a battlefield. There is a sense of consecration, there's a sense of sacred space. The pools that you saw literally sit within the footprints of the Twin Towers. They're about the void that was left in the aftermath of the loss of the towers. The museum is literally below the Memorial Plaza. The plaza is our roof, and you go down 7 stories, you go down 70 feet to what we call bedrock, and you are in the cavity of the foundation of the World Trade Center. So the sense that you are in the place where this happened is very palpable. It's accentuated by the visible presence, the palpable presence of elements of original in situ structure that remains. You're looking at the slurry wall on the left there, which was the retaining wall that was built when the World Trade Center was first under construction in the 60s to keep the Hudson River out of the construction site. They had dug a 16-acre, 7-story hole in Lower Manhattan, and the river was right there. There was no Battery Park City, there was no World Financial Center, there was water. They had to keep the water out. So the slurry wall encases the foundation of the World Trade Center, and you're very conscious of this archaeology, this urban archaeology, when you're in the museum. Mm-hmm. In many respects, most museums are places that house artifacts. We're a museum literally housed within an artifact, and you never lose sight of that sense of place, the power of place, the authentic envelope that you're in. It's constantly referenced as you move through the museum, and it, I think, intensifies the emotion of the experience.
How do you make a place at the same time for recognizing what happened in Pennsylvania and just a few miles from here at the Pentagon?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we are the 9/11 Memorial Museum. So we, in our historical exhibition, we cover all of the sites of the attacks, not just the World Trade Center, the Twin Towers. We have a display on the Pentagon, Flight 77, and the Flight 93 story, of course. So that is all part of the narrative. And we commemorate all of the victims of the attacks, 2,977 people, people on all four planes at all four locations, three locations, mm-hmm. Two towers in New York. And we also commemorate the six people killed in the 1993 World Trade Center bombing, because they also died at this site.
Sarah, let's begin this next question I have with you, but would also enlist you on it, Alice. Each of you have had to deal, forgive me, that's exactly not how I should put it, have been able to enrich what you've done because of the accounts of survivors and family members of people who were most immediately affected. How did you account for what they have to say? How did you account for what must sometimes be their sensitivities at the same time? What role did they play in shaping what you've done here?
Well, let me just start by saying something about Alice's museum, because before even Alice worked there, after the attacks, they fairly quickly brought in some advisors to ask about how to go about memorializing this or creating a museum, and I was one of many people who was asked about it. And having lived through this experience, my answer was, it's too soon. Because we opened 48 years after the event, and I think you opened 13 years? Yes. 13 years after the event. So, you know, mm-hmm. I could just, knowing what we had been through, imagine what it would be like for the families and the survivors, and the process, what they would need from it would be so hard and so complicated. And, you know, they couldn't wait. They had to go forward, and I understand that. We had the luxury of some distance in time so that the survivors were at a different point in their life, and they could reflect back on it, but it wasn't the recent all-consuming part of their thinking about it. We had a committee. We had a committee of survivors and historians and probably not enough educators, but we should have had some educators, talking about the storyline. People participated together. I would say, you know, there were some issues about that. One experience I remember having maybe 8 months before the museum was opened, a survivor who was very involved in the creation came up to me and said very sweetly, well, the exhibit text is going to be in both English and Yiddish, right? And I said, well, you know, it will be about the Yiddish people and the culture and the identity in very many ways, but our audience won't be speaking and reading English, Yiddish. And I said, think of our audience. We used to always say, think of the farmer from Iowa. That's the person who went to come here. We want to introduce the Holocaust and let them think this was important.
Alice, can I get you to talk about, there were people who survived that day, their family members of people who were lost that day. A lot of organization, even before you came into the picture.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it was contentious. There's no way to get around that. You know, you had all of the raw emotion that Sarah's talking about, which is a consequence of trying to crystallize a story that is so fresh and so raw for people. But, you know, there were two parts to our project. There was the creation of the memorial, and family members were invited. This memorial has the names around the two pools. And the names are not alphabetical. They're not organized alphabetically. They're organized by where you were and the context of that day for you. So if you were on one of the planes, if you were on Flight 175, which was hijacked and crashed into Tower 2, the name of those victims would be on the South Pool, the pool which is located where Tower 2 was. But families were invited, actually, to make requests to create what were called adjacencies, meaningful adjacencies, where if their loved one was close to someone at work, a colleague, or was a relative of someone at work, or in some cases, and this was really quite astonishing, met the person that the family wanted their name to be next to on the day of 9/11 in the process of trying to escape or evacuate, they were asked and invited to tell us who they wanted, and we were able, we got 1,200 requests for adjacencies, and we were able to actually honor all of them. So that was one way that families of victims were deeply invested in the process. For the museum, you know, the core of the commemorative part of the museum is our memorial exhibition, where we have a room that is floor to ceiling, all four walls filled with the faces and names of those who were killed, nearly 3,000 people. And we went to families and invited them to submit the portraits that were most meaningful to them. Mm-hmm. They were invited to submit and donate memorabilia, personal effects of their loved ones that could be shared in this exhibition, which you can see here. So there was that level of engagement. But, you know, when you have nearly 3,000 people die, exponentially, close family members number about 10 to 12,000 people. And there's no way to engage all of the families mm-hmm. in a close participatory activity in terms of creating the museum. So we worked with representatives. We have 9 family members on the board of directors. We had a board subcommittee, like your committee, Sarah, that was the program content oversight committee, and the 2 co-chairs were both family members. We had a museum planning conversation series where we brought a group of people together and we thought together and imagined together what this museum could be, and then would come back periodically over a period of 8 years to test our ideas and to test our designs and hear from people. We did that with representatives of not just the family members, but the other constituents, all of whom had their own sense of what this museum should be. You had first responders, you had survivors, you had rescue and recovery workers, Lower Manhattan residents and business owners, landmark preservationists. I mean, we had a large group of people who felt very vested in the outcome of this project, and so we engaged them and we listened.
Are there times when the memorial mission and the educational mission don't exactly run along the same lines?
Yes, I have some stories to tell about that that Alice remembers well. And in a way, the Yiddish story is about that as well. But one is about, and I think we have a picture of our display of hair, the photograph. So in the process of creating the museum, our designers traveled the world and they went to Auschwitz. And if any of you have been there, you know that you see in the barracks of Auschwitz rooms, this is just doesn't do it justice, but full of women's hair that was shaved from the victims and meant to be repurposed. And it was there when the Soviets liberated the camps. And I think our designers were so moved, they said, we have to replicate this feeling. It gives a sense of the magnitude of the crime and the humiliation of the victims, and of course also their individuality. So there was a plan to display actual hair. Auschwitz was gonna loan it to us. It set off a huge debate internally. Alice and I, I'm happy to say, we're on the same side of that debate. I won't tell you which side. But anyway, very big internal debate about whether this was appropriate. And they brought in rabbis to see, you know, was it, you know, theologically appropriate and all this. And they said, no, it's fine. It's not human remains. But the debate kept going on, different sides feeling very strongly about it. And then in this content committee that I mentioned, one day, one of the survivors said, just the thought that my mother or sister's hair could be on display as an object in a museum is too painful for me to bear. Mm-hmm. And that was it. It was over. I mean, Chaika Weinberg, whom Alice referred to, the museum director, said, that's it. And one of the things I learned from him from that experience is that whatever we do, at the core, we are a memorial to these victims. And everything we do, all our education work, all our genocide prevention work, must honor that memory. Another interesting example is we have a part of the museum that shows some very difficult imagery of medical experimentation. And we got a letter from a man in the Netherlands saying that my father was disabled and was a victim of medical experimentation, and you have his picture on display. In fact, we had a few pictures, and I would like you to respectfully remove it. He felt it was an insult to his father's memory. And we debated this back and forth. We had the educational mission. We want our visitors to understand the nature of these criminals, what they were about, the things they would do, their inhumanity. And yet, this was an individual, and we wanted to honor his family. We ended up, there were about three images I think we had shown. We took out all but one, and we left in the one that we felt was least offensive and gave his father the most dignity and humanity.
Let me try and get you to talk a bit about that, too.
Well, I think the tension is exactly the same, even if the details are different. So we see our museum as having both a commemorative function, which is fundamental, central to who we are and what we do, but also an educational function to tell the story of 9/11. We were speaking before the program, and there are kids in high school already for whom 9/11 is past history. They have no lived memory of this event. So we have to teach about it, and we have to provide as accurate a history as we can at this moment in time. We could not tell the story of 9/11 without talking about the perpetrators, the hijackers, Osama bin Laden, Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. You simply can't. It would be as if 9/11 were a tsunami, you know, a natural disaster. It was not a natural disaster. It was planned, perpetrated, conceived, executed by human beings. That's part of the history. So we knew from the very beginning that we would have to include reference to the hijackers. And when we went to our conversation series group with the family members who were there as representatives, and we presented an idea for using images of the hijackers in the exhibit, some family members, and it's really important to say that there's no monolithic family member response to anything. You know, you're talking about, you know, thousands and thousands of people. They have a range of views. But there were some family members who felt particularly strongly that how could we, in the same space, have a portrait of their loved one in the memorial exhibit and have a portrait of their murderer in the same place? And we went to interesting lengths to respond to that concern. One, we segregated the memorial exhibit completely from the history exhibit. One sits on, literally on the footprint of the South Tower, the other sits on the footprint of the North Tower, so they are separated physically. Mm-hmm. The other thing is, as you can see here, we chose images that actually have a little yellow stamp on them. You can see that there. That is the FBI evidence sticker. These are images that were placed into evidence in the U.S. versus Moussaoui trial. So they are pictures of criminals, simply by virtue of the fact that you've got the evidence sticker on them. They are organized by the flights that they were on. So this is a narrative about what happened and who did it. It is not a glorification of these individuals in their own rights. So we're not giving you their biographies. We're not telling you where they went to school. We're not celebrating them. We are presenting them as part of the narrative, as actors in the narrative. And that's a very different way of thinking about the presentation.
But I do have to ask, and obviously we get this in the news business, what do you say to people who, well, you gave them what they wanted. You gave them prominence.
Well, it's in the context of a much larger exhibition. I remember years ago we tried to figure out what, you know, the museum is 110,000 square feet, and the historical exhibition is about 22,000 square feet, and this takes up about 500 square feet. So, you know, standing there, I mean, it's not a big part of the exhibition. It is in the context of telling the story. It is not a glorification. Yeah, we all know who they are, okay? But to not include them would be, in my estimation, like trying to tell the story of the Holocaust without mentioning the Nazis.
Well, that we get, because it's, I've always told people it's important to it's important to remember this was 6 million people, 3,000 people didn't die in a hurricane. It was a crime.
Yeah, no, I think the perpetrators was an issue for us, and actually we took a slightly different approach. I think we have some pictures here of the perpetrators, but if you look at our exhibit was done with the same, well, let me start by saying the story, of course, has what we call like the characters, if you will. There's obviously the victims, there's the perpetrators, there's people we used to call bystanders, the onlookers, and then the heroes of our story to the extent there are rescuers. So this picture shows an early scene of people being humiliated for what so-called race defilement, relations between Aryans and Jews. And I think the important part, your attention goes to the woman being humiliated and the Nazis, but really the most important people in this picture are the two women. And the question is, who are these women? What are they thinking? They seem to be smiling. These are what we call the onlookers. And frankly, there will always be evil people in the world. There will always be victims in the world. Evil things happen mostly because of the onlookers, and we all end up in that category sooner or later. So that's how we treat them. The Shaika Weinberg, we keep referring to him, but he once said, I created a museum about bystanders for bystanders. And that thread is there. It's just hard to do a museum about something that didn't happen. Now, when you get to the victims, this is how most of the victims look in a Holocaust museum. And the people who created the museum were very concerned that our visitor would see these degraded, emaciated, skeletal people and not be able to identify with them. Because if you look at a picture such as the next one I think we have of Hitler Youth, look at how happy and radiant these young so-called Aryan children look. And we wanted our visitor to identify with these victims. So we put the victims at the front of the story and we go to a lot of length to show them actually before they became victims in the fullness of their lives. But what happened at the end is that I think that the perpetrators moved to the background and are not in the foreground. And you'll have to search kind of hard to find the perpetrators. If we go to some of these, you'll find this picture is at the end of the exhibit. You have to kind of look up. We have a few showing the perpetrators in their acts of humiliation. But there's been a shift, I think, in the museum over the last 24 years. When we opened, the exhibition really said, the Holocaust happened, and here's exactly how it happened. And now, as we want to be more relevant to younger generations, for whom this might as well be the War of 1812, that will soon be your problem, is we want to talk about why the Holocaust happened, what made it possible. And to do that, you have to bring these perpetrators out and talk about who they are, who they were. They weren't killers before Nazism. They were leading fairly ordinary lives. And we know now a lot about the motivation of some of these killers. Some were true believers. Many of them did it for the most mundane reasons, like career advancement, peer approval, greed, things like that. So I think we feel it is very important to bring the perpetrator back, and in a way it's going to sound odd, not to bring back some of their humanity, because to remind ourselves that this is a museum about human nature and it's about all of us. We all have potential along this horrible spectrum of human behavior.
I have to ask, not 3 or 4 days go by that I don't get an email from Facebook, Twitter message from a denier. People who deny the Holocaust happened, people who do believe, I don't want to go into the theories, but yeah, people who think that 9/11 wasn't real. To what degree do you consider your institutions a place where doubters can come and learn the truth, or is there any communication with them?
Well, I would, doubters is a nice, I would call that a little euphemistic.
Well, I am speaking of, let's say, the 15-year-old kid growing up today.
That's the person we want to reach. Yeah. It's an inoculation program, if you will, to reach
someone who says this sounds impossible.
Who are susceptible to the deniers. Yeah. You know, Deborah Lipstadt wrote a great book about Holocaust denial many years ago, and these are not people interested in truth or historic inquiry. These are anti-Semites. So the question is, how do we neutralize them? There's no real conversation with them. I mean, the Holocaust is probably the best documented crime in history. We have, you know, millions of pages upstairs written by the perpetrators bragging about how many Jews they've killed. So that's not the problem. But the idea is to get to young people early and for people to see that this is important history and it's worth knowing about and it's relevant to you. That really is the best antidote to denial is good education.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very much the same. We don't entertain dialogue with the 9/11 truther community. We tell the story and we document what happened, not just in an objective way through, you know, news reports, but from the inside. It is what human beings experienced on that day. When you go through the historical exhibition, you don't even get there until after you've been in this large, almost beyond imagination, huge scale space. You've seen the memorial exhibition. You understand the human toll of the event. You come into the story of 9/11, and we take you moment by moment through the day. So you are experiencing it as those of us who were alive on that day witnessed it, whether watching television or on the street in Lower Manhattan or wherever. You were having a sequence of emotions that are replicated in the way we tell this story. So you are, Sarah just said something about relating, seeing yourself in the story, and that is very much the way you engage audiences for who come in and say, this has nothing to do with me. Mm-hmm. Suddenly, they're feeling a human emotion that we all felt. And it is very real, very powerful, very profound. You move through the events of the day, you come to a section that is about the who did this and why. But then you come out again into what we call 9/12, the world after 9/11, which is also rooted in personal stories, personal experience. And we take you through not only the recovery and what happened in the 9 months at Ground Zero, the year at the Pentagon, but we give you the scientific analysis that was done on why the different buildings fell, the work that was done by NIST here in Gaithersburg, Maryland, the National Institute of Science and Technology, which did all the forensic study on the steel coming from Manhattan. They did work, as well as the FAA did work, on the planes, what happened inside the planes. So we simply present the evidence. And there's no apology for it. We are not trying to prove a point. We are simply saying, this is what happened. And we allow the exhibition to speak for itself. We do acknowledge that there are questions. We acknowledge that people question the veracity of this story, but we provide the scientific evidence to refute it.
Could I get you, before we go to questions, each of you to talk about what the architecture and the use of space has suggested in each of the museums, how you've tried to use that to make a statement and create a presence and a feeling with people.
I think we have some pictures of our architecture here. So our architect, who James Ingo Fried, was himself a refugee from Nazi Germany, wanted the architecture not to represent the Holocaust, but more to evoke aspects of it. So for him, it was very important that as you entered the building, you were being sent various signals that you're entering a place where the world is upside down, if you will. Civilization is fractured. Here you see in the Hall of Witness upstairs some of that putting you off kilter. You see in the next photograph, I think we have a little bit of the industrial nature of the building. You can see that he's actually, it's a little bit hard to see, but if you look on the right-hand side of your screen, the HVAC system is somewhat exposed with those industrial vents. If you look on the left, You see, this is the entrance here to our exhibit for young children. If you see the way the steel is used to brace the brick, he was inspired by having seen at places like Auschwitz and Majdanek the way the crematoria were built, and they too were built of brick. They too were braced with steel so that they would not explode from overuse. So again, this is in his head. This is evocative. And then I think we have one last one I just want to show you. This grand staircase, which actually very gradually narrows as it gets to the top, very reminiscent of that railroad track leading into Auschwitz. But what is at the top? It's actually a window, but it's a boarded up window. If you look out that window, if you look through the slats where you can see, what do you see? The Washington Monument. So do you see this tension that he's always creating between the inside and the outside? The other thing that's important is this magnificent glass skylight that covers this entire Hall of Witness. You know, his point, the Holocaust happened really in many ways in the light of day. We knew early, everybody knew. And also he was struck by the fact that you would hear accounts from the victims that would say, I would look up at the sky and think that sky, that sun is shining on me, but also on people in the free world. And they would see birds or butterflies and, of course, think about the freedom that had been denied them. So that skylight is a theme repeated throughout the museum.
Well, you know, I think memory itself is a intersection of cognitive understanding and emotional intelligence. And so when one is in a memorial museum, you are learning through the mind, but also through the heart. And the architecture becomes the visceral expression, much as it is here in Jim Fried's magnificent design. It becomes the space in which you learn by feeling it. So I mentioned the slurry wall earlier. One of the things that happened with this project being at the site of Ground Zero, the World Trade Center site, is that the site itself was eligible for landmark status. And the project had received federal money, which was part of the appropriation that Congress gave to rebuild all of Lower Manhattan. A portion of it came for the memorial and the museum. And once you receive federal money, as Sarah knows, you are obligated to follow federal law. We fell under, because of the landmark status eligibility, we fell under the Federal Preservation Act, and we were required to make these remnants of structure that were still at the site meaningfully accessible, visible to the public. Well, the only way you can see something that is 70 feet below ground is to go 70 feet below ground. So our architects had the challenge of creating a space. They were building a building that you could not see because it was below ground. There was no other than our entry pavilion, which was a separate architectural firm, Snaheta. Davis Brody Bond, who were the architects of the below grade space, had to come up with a mechanism for conveying meaning in a non-building, because you were going into the bowels of the vacant cavity of the World Trade Center. So they allowed this slurry wall, this environment that we were in, to accentuate the authentic space, while they inserted a way for us to move down that seven stories that was the architectural insertion. And they chose a ramp. Now, why did they choose a ramp? They could have put us in elevators and we could have gone straight down. But they wanted to do something that was both tied to the site and also strategic in terms of the emotional affect of the visitor. So there was always a construction ramp at the World Trade Center when it was under construction in the 60s. After 9/11, the Hall Road was put in. That was the road that went down to Ground Zero, was used to bring the debris out. But it was also the way that family members and dignitaries would go down to Ground Zero to pay respects. So they inserted a ramp that you, a slight descent, that you walk down as you move into this space. And that descent gives you a kind of processional aspect. Mm-hmm. You feel like you're processing towards something. It generates an attitude of reverence. And as you move down the ramp, there are these periodic vistas that open in front of you. And you see this space and you get a sense of scale, but you also get a sense of the authentic. And you're moving into the space before you're ever told the story. There are hints about it. We begin with the voices of people from around the world remembering where they were on 9/11. This was a global event. It wasn't just an event in the States. But it is more about the physical environment that is actually conveying meaning in an affective, emotive way. So when you see the slurry wall for the first time from that overlook, you honestly don't know what you're looking at. You know it's big. You understand that it's probably original because it doesn't look finished. But you don't fully get it. It's in a space called Foundation Hall. You're going to come back to Foundation Hall multiple times in your visit, when you arrive at Bedrock, when you come out of the historical exhibition. And the slurry wall, which is 60 feet high by 60 feet wide, the portion that is exposed here, the whole thing still rings the site. But in human scale, it is overwhelming. It's enormous. Now, the slurry wall has a story. It wasn't just the retaining wall that was built in the old days. And when the buildings were standing, the lateral bracing of the underground parking garage floors, which is where you're standing when you're looking into the space for the first time, that held the slurry wall in place. On 9/11, two 110-story buildings crash into the site. And what is now holding the slurry wall in place is the debris. But the debris had to be removed. So as the recovery workers removed layer after layer after layer of debris, they had to reinforce this wall with these tiebacks, their anchors shot through the concrete, into bedrock on the other side. They reinforce it, but there was evidence of cracking that was found soon after the recovery effort began. Mayor Giuliani was notified of this, Governor Pataki, FEMA. It was not made public because the authorities did not want to panic an already panicked community. But had the slurry wall breached, the subway tunnels in Lower Manhattan would have flooded and Lower Manhattan would have been inundated. So they worked very hard. They watched it for 9 months. Mm-hmm. They reinforced, they reinforced, they reinforced. The end of the 9 months, the wall had held. And when Daniel Libeskind, the architect who was the master site planner for the rebuilding at Ground Zero, learns the story of the slurry wall, he, in his proclivity to be metaphoric in his architecture, sees the wall as the physical metaphor of the strength, the endurance, the resilience of our nation and our national values. So when you are standing at the foot of the slurry wall, when you finally get down to bedrock and it is 60 feet above you, you are overwhelmed by the majesty of this raw evidence of what was once simply a foundation. And the meaning is multi-layered. It's not just Foundation Hall because you're looking at a foundational structure of the World Trade Center. It's Foundation Hall because you're at Ground Zero, but the valence has now changed. It is not Ground Zero where something horrific happened. It is Ground Zero for where you build up from. And that is the message of the museum. So you're feeling it as much as knowing it, and I think that's the role of the architecture in this space.
Let me call for the cards now and questions that will be coming up, and if you could pass them out to ushers who were there. Let me ask another question while the cards are being prepared. Each of your museums also has a role to play as a collector of artifacts and important clues and tokens. And the word memento is hardly encompasses it. But at the same time, can I get you each to talk about the role that you have of keeping collections that are available to the public and scholars?
Well, I would say that we have talked a lot about Chaika Weinberg, and it's appropriate because he is the founding genius of this institution. And he said, this is not an object-based museum, this is a storytelling museum. That the objects you see here mean nothing outside of the context of this story. So the objects here, so here you see, for example, the barracks. The objects here are obvious, they're authentic, they tell the story, but they are meant to also provide mood, environment, emotional power, authenticity at the same time. So this is what we euphemistically call this museum open case design, which means there's no case. In most museums you go and you see objects in cases. You know, I think it's fair to say a shoe is pretty much just a shoe, except if you're seeing a shoe in this museum, and you all are familiar with our shoes. Another example of open case design. You don't really need a text panel to explain what you're seeing with the shoes, but they advance, and I think Alice referred to it at the 9/11 Museum, this goal of the education and the emotional moments, this pacing that the exhibit journey puts you through, and this is obviously one of those emotional moments. And I think we have another picture here of also the railroad car, also an artifact, but you literally, you know, you walk through it. This is not typical of most museums. Now, I should add, and this is probably true for Alice as well, that in addition to objects on display, our collection has been used by the Justice Department to help track down Nazis living illegally in this country. It's been used by survivors documenting claims for compensation. Frankly, Scott, you talked about denial. To me, it plays a role in providing the authentic evidence. Mm-hmm. Most importantly, perhaps, it's also a memorial. So it performs many roles. I just wanted to tell you a little story about scholarship because it's fairly recent. A scholar was actually here looking through actually some records from the Stasi. Anybody who's old enough to remember the Cold War, you remember that the East German secret police, their version of the KGB, were called the Stasi. We have the Stasi records. After the war, the communists had a lot of trials for the Nazis. And they found information on this woman. Her name is Erna Petri. It turns out that she was married, her husband was in the SS. They went together into occupied Poland, and she actually started committing murders with him, including killing children. And out of discovering this evidence, just on a, you know, just a document in the archive, she wrote a book on women in the SS. And it's an extraordinary story. It was a finalist for a National Book Award. So even 70 years after the Holocaust, the collection is still helping us understand what happened.
I'm going to share a Chaika Weinberg story about artifacts, because, you know, as curators, artifacts are everything. They're the objects. They're the connection to another human being who might have touched them or owned them. They're the palpable evidence of history. And he did feel very strongly that, you know, artifacts were okay, but they were secondary to mm-hmm. the story. And over the years, this didn't change. I mean, we got a beautiful storytelling museum here, incredibly powerful. But I remember going to him one day and saying, you know, Chaika, if there were a fire in the museum, what would you run and take out? And and he said, without hesitation, the Ringelblum milk can. This was the milk can that was hidden in the Warsaw ghetto with the archive of the Jewish community. So he talked a good game, but this was a man who really got objects in a very profound way. Our collections, we had to build them from scratch, but we had the advantage of an extraordinary situation, which is the World Trade Center is owned by the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey, a bi-state agency, not known for historic preservation. It's not what they do. They manage bridges and tunnels and airports. And immediately after 9/11, the Port Authority had this prescience, this sense that this was a historic event that needed to be documented. And they sent architects, engineers, and curators went into the field, into the pile, in the early weeks of the recovery, and with spray paint cans, identified pieces of steel that should be saved either because they could be used forensically for engineering studies, or because they would help tell the story. Mm-hmm. So this material, which represented less than 0.5% of all of the debris, which was 1.8 million tons of debris at Ground Zero, filled an 80,000 square foot airline hangar, Tower Air at JFK. Mm. So we had an extraordinary amount of material to choose from for the exhibition, but also as the basis of our collection. We obviously went out and encouraged family members, witnesses, survivors to also contribute material. We've built the collection over the years, and it is for research, it's for scholars, it's for lending to other museums and other organizations. We have loaned a piece of World Trade Center steel to NATO headquarters in Brussels. And the power of that is that 9/11 was the first time in history that Article 5 was invoked. And Article 5 is the rule that all NATO members, if one is attacked, it is as if all have been attacked. It had never been invoked before. So standing in front of the new headquarters in Brussels at the end of this year will be a piece of World Trade Center steel. So we share what we have. We learn from it. One of the areas where there needs to be much more documentation now, because the situation is becoming more and more and more acute, is the matter of 9/11 related illness and the deaths that are occurring as a result of exposure to World Trade Center dust. There are going to be probably tens of thousands of fatalities as a result of that exposure. There are now thousands of people suffering from cancers, and we are beginning to collect the documentation, working with various legal firms, law firms that have worked in the litigation on this, to document what has happened, what has been done, and to be able to tell that story too.
Mm-hmm. Let me get to questions. Now, we're apparently getting a lot of questions, I guess, both within the audience and the digital audience, who are asking about the evolution of both of your museums to include terrorism. One of the things that certainly has made my wife and I very devoted to this museum is the idea that history doesn't stop in 1945, but has continued on with Bosnia, Rwanda, Somalia. Alas, we could both go on. Are you now expanding to try and encompass questions about terrorism? And certainly in your case, Alice, what happened at 9/11 is often seen as obviously a salvo in a struggle that continues.
Well, I would say terrorism per se is not within our mandate. However, genocide and related crimes against humanity is. So we have the Simon Scott Center for the Prevention of Genocide, and about 2 years ago sent a very brave young woman on staff, the granddaughter of Holocaust survivors, I should add. She wanted to go into northern Iraq to find refugees from ISIS, people who had survived ISIS, to document those crimes. And she came back, she's a lawyer, and she wrote up a report based on the evidence she gathered, and she made a determination that they had indeed committed genocide. And this led both the State Department and Congress to agree with that finding. So I would say, unfortunately, terrorism, extremism, and genocide are converging these days, but that's where we would enter that topic.
One of the great challenges of the 9/11 Memorial Museum was that we knew that we had a story to tell that was specific to where we were located, specific to a moment in time, but it was a story that wasn't over yet. So, you know, museums are finite spaces, exhibitions are finite spaces, but this is a story that wasn't finite. So we had to figure out how to balance those two realities. What we did was focus on the events that happened at this site. So we take you chronologically through to the end of the recovery in 2002. But the historical exhibition doesn't end there. It continues with a set of questions that come out of 9/11 that we are still negotiating. We haven't figured out the answers yet. Questions like, in a world where terrorism is a real and present threat, how do democracies protect the homeland while also ensuring the preservation and protection of civil liberties? We have not worked that out yet. So these questions that come out of this event have defined the post 9/11 world, defined the world we live in, and that opens us up through our programming, through areas in the museum where we track news events that have come from 9/11 but are happening in this moment in time. We have it's called the Timescape, and every day there are news stories on the wall that are directly related to what started in 2001. So we are not a museum about preventing terrorism, because we don't fundamentally believe that that's possible. You can try your best, and God knows our agencies are doing that. They're trying very hard to protect us. But as Margaret Thatcher said, you know, the terrorists only have to be right once. We have to be right every time. So it's not about that. It's about being aware of the, both on the one hand, the tensions in the world that lead to this kind of action and tragedy, but also the other side of the coin, that if we don't have any control over terrorism, the one thing we do have control over is our own response to it. And in many respects, we're the 9/12 museum as much as the 9/11 museum. And that's where we can provide a hopeful message.
Lauren on Twitter asks, is there a limit as to how much you will push your audience emotionally?
Yeah.
How do you decide what to include?
Absolutely. And you know, we spent 8 years trying to figure out what would go into this museum. And the debates were just so furious and intense. We really had to think about what was appropriate to present in the public space of a museum. 9/11 happened on the cusp of the beginning of the 21st century. We have access to the most extraordinary documentation. We have 911 calls. We have radio transmissions of firefighters in the building. We have cockpit voice recorders where you hear the hijackers' voices and their intention. Mm-hmm. We had to decide what was appropriate and what wasn't appropriate, and we made choices not to include material, even though it exists, even though you can find it on the internet.
On YouTube, Leaping Man, and
but
that sort
we,
of thing.
Yeah. We felt that we had an obligation to be respectful of both the families of the victims and of the people we were there to commemorate. And there were certain things that were off limits that we would not include, and it didn't take away from our ability to tell the story.
I would say that a big discussion all along the way was to make sure you did not sentimentalize the history, that you did not manipulate the visitor. Nothing worse than a visitor who feels that their emotions are being manipulated. Mm-hmm. And there was a sense here that the facts are so extraordinary. Just tell them in the most basic, understated way. I think Shaika used to say there will be no adjectives or adverbs in any of the exhibition text. Just say the facts. And frankly, he's right. It's just put out there what happened. Now, we did go to great lengths to minimize graphic imagery. In today's world, it looks almost a little bit silly, but then it was a big discussion. There's only three places that you see very difficult imagery. We felt we had to do that. They're behind privacy walls. You see people using them here. But our goal is not to shock, it's to educate and to get people to think and to ask deep questions and do critical thinking about their role in society. So if you just come out and say, oh my God, people are so horrible to one another. If that's your answer, then we failed. It's not the horror that is the message here. It's that this happened in an advanced Western society, highly educated, with a democratic constitution, a rule of law, a free press. That society went into total social collapse and genocide. That's what we want people thinking about, not necessarily the details of how they committed mass murder, although we must document that. That's very important as well.
Question, obviously, for you, Sarah. I understand the Memorial Museum is in Holocaust Memorial Museum is in a process of redesign or a renewal of the permanent exhibit. Would you talk about the narratives and new discoveries in history the last 20 years that will be engaged in the new permanent exhibit?
So yes, it's a revitalization. The exhibit is brilliant, and our first motto is "Do no harm." But it is old, and one of the big things that happened since the museum opened, really at the fall of the Soviet Union, access to millions and millions of pages of archives and stories that don't really get their due in that exhibition. Our collection has grown dramatically. But more importantly, we've done a lot of exhibitions that examine this why question, and we want that to be incorporated in this. So for example, we did an exhibit because of the rise of the internet on Nazi propaganda and their approach to their techniques and using the latest technology of their day. I mean, they would be all over social media today. They were earlier than everybody else to understand its power. Another example I mentioned before was an exhibit we did on collaboration and complicity, where we now understand so much more about human motivation, and we can tell a lot of very simple stories about ordinary people who had choices to help or not help. I mean, this is just a very interesting picture here. You see a local town, their neighbors have just been deported, all their Jewish neighbors. And what are they doing? They're at a public auction of the personal belongings of their neighbors, buying things cheaply.
Seen that.
Well, you have to come see this exhibition, Scott.
I've been all over. I've never seen that.
It's just down this hallway here.
We'll begin with you, Alice, but both of you certainly would have something to say on this. In your efforts to engage young people, how do you view the role of digital education and technology within the museum? You know, they're young people these days are bored by stuff that's 5 years old sometimes.
Well, we actually use a lot of digital technology in the telling of the 9/11 story. It was the most digitally documented event of all time, up until now. And so, you know, we actually hired a design team that brought media designers on board immediately. So we conceptualized the museum in terms of the application of available tools and innovation. But I would have to say that, you know, if people go through our museum and are focusing on the technology, then we really miss the mark. The technology is there because we use it as the best way to tell the story. It's always in the service of storytelling. So what you're looking at right here is an interface that is just in front of something known as the last column. The last column is a 36-foot tall core column from the South Tower that ended up being the very last piece of Twin Tower steel to be brought out of the World Trade Center site at the end of the recovery in May 2002. And before it was brought out of the site, recovery workers signed their names, pasted missing posters, mass cards, memorabilia, left messages, all, it's like a totem of recovery. And at the end of the recovery, it was cut down in a ceremony, laid on a flatbed truck covered with a shroud and an American flag, and it was escorted out of the site by honor guard. It is now standing upright in the museum as evidence of the community that coalesced around the recovery, both literally and in the broader sense of the world coming together after 9/11. And in order to allow our visitors to interrogate all of the inscriptions on the last column, we have this interface that you work like an iPhone. You move it up and down and around, and you can see things that are 36 feet above you that you couldn't see otherwise. And it's an intimate engagement with the inscriptions, and there are hot spots. You go beyond the inscription to learn about the person who wrote it, or the company they were with, or the unit they were with. So it gives you access. And I think The use of technology, if it's going to be effective, must be that it is the best and most potent way of telling your story. So I'm just going to give one more example, and that is, we have an enormous number of oral histories of people who evacuated and escaped and tell their story, of first responders. We wanted to give people access to that material, but inviting people to sit and listen to an hour-long oral history is not necessarily the most effective use of people's time or the most effective way to tell the story. So as you move through the events of the day, there are what we call audio alcoves in strategic moments. And inside these alcoves, you are able to literally hear the story of an evacuation, but told by multiple people, each from their own perspective. They're snippets of oral histories interwoven in some cases with actual authentic archival recording. So you're using oral history in a completely new way. It creates the narrative. And actually, we have one example of it, if we have time to just share a snippet. This is in one of the alcoves relating to the rescue, first responders. It's a firefighter by the name of Oreo Palmer, who did not survive on 9/11. And we asked permission from his family. We did that routinely if we were using actual recordings of people who died in the, or were killed in the events. And you're listening and you're in that moment. So I don't know if we can pull that up. It's the, it's a quick, yeah. Okay, so you're looking at the towers, they're just wireframes. And now you're gonna hear this snippet of one of these audio experiences.
Yeah, 10-4. We're on 71. We're coming up behind you.
Hey, 9-4-1-5. We got two isolated pockets of fire. We should be able to knock it down with two lines. Where you go that? 78th floor. No more 10-45. Call horns.
478.
10-4. We got no more civilians. We're going to get two engines up here.
All right, 10-4. We're on our way.
So that content is also interspersed with the memories and recollections of people who were evacuating, the people who were going down as these guys were going up. And so you get a very immediate, very powerful sense of what that day was like, literally the inside story. And that's where the media tells, allows us to tell the story, but you're not focused on the media, you're focused on the story.
Yeah. Sarah.
I don't want to follow that. That was, I couldn't even actually read the words. I could just hear the tone of the voice, and it's quite moving. Like Alice, I'm skeptical of technology. You can have a lot of activity and not a real engagement. We are doing some experiments right now. Right now we have an opportunity to do virtual reality for visitors and actually enter a destroyed city in Syria. And you actually tour the city and you can see the massive destruction perpetrated by the Assad regime. We also have an opportunity here. This is a little bit hard to tell what's happening, but that's actually a shipping container. And this experiment is over now, but it was an opportunity to actually talk to somebody, a refugee, who had fled either Syria or ISIS. And was either they were either in, I think, Germany or Turkey in refugee camps, and talk in real time, face to face, about their experience. So there's a translator on the other end, and this actually is a Holocaust survivor talking to one of these survivors. So again, it's like Alice said, it's not about the technology, how we do it. We're trying to really humanize the experience of fleeing ISIS. What is it like to have survived that?
I have two questions to conclude our time together, and both of you have been hosts to so many names we would recognize who have come to visit your museums. I'm wondering who you remember. I bet it may not be some of the most recognizable names.
Well, I would say, first of all, the most important people that walk through our doors are young people. And just to see them and to see them interacting with survivors, that's the best feeling in the world, and you think you have the best job in the world. But we were visited, do we all remember when, well, I see some young people here, Washington was the murder capital of the world. Some of us remember that, and we imported a new police chief from Chicago. His name was Charles Ramsey. I think we have a picture of Chief Ramsey here. And Chief Ramsey came, and shortly after taking office here to fix our city, he came on a tour with David Friedman, the head of our ADL chapter here. And Chief Ramsey came out of the exhibition, and he said, you know, I was deeply moved as a human being, but I was really taken aback as a police officer. I saw my own profession in your museum, and I kept asking myself, how did my profession get on the walls of your museum? And he had this idea, it was solely his idea, to create a training program for all recruits to the Washington, D.C. police force that would look at the slow evolution of German policing from the democracy of Weimar Germany into the early stages of the Nazi period and then into war and genocide. And this program, which examines that evolution, it's not just about their moral compass, it's about their professional ethics, their role in society, their relationship to the Constitution. And it became so popular that the then head of the FBI asked if we could replicate it for every new FBI agent. So now we do law enforcement, FBI, military, the judiciary in the same type of program. And it was all because Chief Ramsey walked in this museum and had an idea about us that was so much bigger than we understood we were.
Such a great story. Well, you know, as a Jewish girl from Long Island, meeting the Pope was pretty incredible. I just have to, that was just amazing. And he's truly, what you see is what you get. He's truly an extraordinary human being.
He's very Hamish, isn't he?
Very Hamish.
Yeah.
He wears a yarmulke.
As Pope goes, yeah, I know, yeah, yeah.
No, he's a truly, truly, he's a mensch. This man is a mensch, that's all I can say. He doesn't know that, but he is.
No, actually, I bet he does know that.
He probably does.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
You know, we've had presidents, we had the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge, but I have to tell you, the people who matter are not the ones whose names you necessarily know. Yeah. And just a few weeks ago, we have a recording studio on the premises. We invite our visitors to tell their 9/11 story. That can be added to one of the exhibits on a periodic basis. We invite people to share memories. If they knew someone who was killed on 9/11, they can share a memory that is incorporated into the memorial exhibition regularly. They can answer some of those tough questions that we end the historical exhibition with and engage in dialogue with other visitors and other people who've answered those questions. Or you can just leave a message. And a few weeks ago, a message was left by a young man, Jordan Kolodner was his name, 18 years old, who had come to the museum on his birthday to stand in front of his mother's portrait in the memorial exhibition. And we would not have known this. This is a woman who worked at Marsh & McLennan High in the North Tower, obviously killed on that day. And as he, I don't know how he could do this, but in the most composed way possible, he told us about his experience that day, that he had come to our museum to spend his birthday with his mom. And what he most wanted is for her to be proud of the man he had become. That, to me, is what this museum is here to do. It's a place of healing. It's a place where you can mourn. It's a place where you can recognize the best of yourself, which was what was demonstrated after 9/11. In the face of the worst possible demonstration of what we can do as human beings, we saw the best. And Jordan reminded me of that when I heard that recording. That's the most memorable one right now for me.
I'm not sure I want to follow that with another question, but we want to give maximum value here. There's so much information available online now. There's so many people who believe that they can and do learn things electronically, almost Well, virtual reality, in fact. You've been dabbling with that here. What is the role of a museum in an age when many people think that you can essentially sit in chairs like we're occupying now and learn pretty much what you need to? And we are all pathetically dependent on those technologies, too.
I think the museum is going to become more important as we go off in our echo chambers and live on our social media with like-minded opinions. To me, it's a place where you bring strangers together and they have sometimes a shared experience or they're in the same place, but you create an experience, an environment, and you stimulate a new set of conversations. And when I look at what's happening to communities and to our education system, I think that the role of museums will become more important in teaching everything from history, civics, but also how to have conversations with people that you know and people you don't know, especially difficult conversations. And I think both of our institutions will play a bigger role in the civic life of this nation in the future.
Totally agree with that. There are studies that have found that museums are at the top of the list of the most trustworthy places to learn. And I take that very seriously, that yeah. People don't trust half of what they see online.
For good reason.
For good reason.
Yeah.
And museums are the gold standard right now of places to learn, and they are places of informal education where it can be communally experienced, talk to the person you're with, engage in conversation, but it is trustworthy and we need to honor that. We have an obligation to provide the accurate history. But even more, in a world where virtual is everywhere, mm-hmm. encountering reality is really important. And there's nothing more real than the shoes in the Holocaust Museum. There's nothing more real than that boxcar. There's nothing more real than the slurry wall. There's nothing more real than the wallet that belonged to a woman killed on 9/11 who had gone to Windows on the World the night before, and the receipt is still in the wallet. This is real life. And I think the palpable reality that one experiences in museums, with all the media enhancements, it's that connection that you make to other human beings and to real human experience, human choices. That, to me, is the role of the museum.
Well, we want to thank you all very much for being here. Both of these institutions have important and even more important than ever roles to play in uncertain times in an uncertain future where we look for illumination and moral compass at the same time. Thank you very much for joining all of us tonight. Thank you, Sarah and for Alice.